All right, good morning. It's good to see everyone here this morning. I hope you've had a blessed week. Hope you're looking forward to another blessed week this week. We have a lot to be in prayer for, but we also have a lot to celebrate, and so glad you chose to come and worship with us this morning in person, of course, via the internet for those who are watching us online. If you're a first-time visitor with us, let me encourage you to take just a moment, fill out a visitor card there in the back of your pew. Place that in the offering plate in just a moment when the ushers come around so that we have a record of your visit with us this morning. Let's start our worship service out by going to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this day. God, we know that today is a day that you have made. God, we have gathered together to rejoice and be glad in it. And God, we just give you praise for the blessings upon our life. God, we thank you for health and strength. Lord, for the ability that we have to be here. Lord, I pray that everything that's said and done this morning and sang will be glorifying and uplifting to you. God, I pray that you'll meet each one of us at our point of need. Lord, that you'll convict our hearts, Lord, if there's anything in our life that we need to be convicted of and to lay before you. And God, if we're burdened this morning, we pray that today you draw us to that place we might lay our burdens down, Lord, that we might put our faith even deeper in you. And so God, I pray that you'll meet with us today. But God, most of all, I pray that if there's one here this morning who's lost without you, we pray that today be the day of salvation. Lord, that today someone will give their life to Christ and be eternally and forever changed. And God, we thank you and we praise you again for this day. Lord, help us to rejoice and be glad in it. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Good morning. It is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Hymn number 581, please stand.
Just to rest upon his promise, just to know.
God. As you make your way back to your seat, as you can see, we got a different crew up here today. But we're gathered together today to worship. And the beautiful thing about it, about worship, about coming to Christ, is that He says that we can come just as we are. That He doesn't say that you have to clean your life up before you come. He doesn't say that you've got to get rid of everything that you've ever done, make wrong every right, or make right every wrong, however you say that, before you come to Him. But He says, just come as you are. Come, give your life to Him, and let Him work from the inside out. And so we want to sing about that this morning. We ask you to join with us. Come, just as you are.
Just as you are, hear the Spirit call. Come just as you are, come and see, come receive, come and live forever. Come just as
Father, we come to you so thankful, God, that we are able to come just as we are. God, that you don't require us to clean ourselves up. God, that we're not required to deal with every sin and every mistake we've ever made before we approach you. But God, you said, just come as you are. Lay our life down before you. And God, that is my prayer. Lord, that each and every one here this morning has laid their life down before you, has came just as they are. And God, if there are any here today who's not come just as they are. They've never came to you. They've never given their life to you. God, I pray that today be the day of salvation for that person. God, we are so thankful, Lord, that you love us unconditionally. God, that you're patient with us. And God, that you care for us and that you have just poured out grace and mercy upon us. Lord, even though we are far from deserving your presence in our life and your blessings. But God, we thank you. And we have gathered together today to give you praise and to thank you for all that you have done. So, God, I pray that you'll see our hearts this morning. God, that you see where we are. And, God, that you'll move in our life, that you'll draw us to a deeper, more intimate personal relationship with you. But God, we also gather together this morning to pray for those who are hurting, pray for those who are needing a healing, needing a touch from you, those who are sick, those who are in the hospital, those unable to be here for whatever reason. God, we ask that you minister to them. Lord, you know our prayer list. Lord, you know the needs, and we ask that you be with each and every one of them. And God, we pray for the shut-ins. Lord, those who would love to be here more than anything else but just can't because they're unable to due to health circumstances or what other circumstances may be. We pray that you'll bless them. You'll minister to them. Lord, that you'll reach down, draw them close to you, and let them know that you are near. And God, we pray for our nation. We pray for our president all the way down to our local officials. And Lord, we pray that you'll use them, guide them, be with them however you see fit. God, we know and we understand, Lord, what your word says. You are the one who raises leaders. You're the one who brings down leaders. You're the one who raises nations. You're the one who brings down nations. God, our trust is in you. Lord, our trust is not in the leaders, but God, we do. Would love to see them come to know you. God, that they give their heart, their life to you if they don't know you. And God, we pray for the church. We lift the church up to you, the universal church, the body of Christ. Lord, I pray that you will continue to move and minister and bless. Lord, that many might come to know you as a result of the work of the church. Lord, I pray specifically for Providence Baptist Church. Lord, I pray that you'll work among us, move among us, draw us into a deeper relationship with you as we go out and we reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And God, I just pray that you will just meet with us this morning. Lord, I pray for those, Lord, who have suffered loss, Lord, and are in a time of grieving. Lord, I pray that you'll just touch their life. Lord, I pray that you'll give them comfort. Lord, that you'll let them know that you're near and that you care for them. And Lord, we know that this is not just a week-long, month-long process. God, some have experienced it some years ago and still in a time of grief. And God, we pray that you'll be with them. Lord, that you'll minister to them. And Lord, I pray that you'll meet with all of us here today. Lord, that our eyes, our ears, our hearts might be open to see, to hear, and to receive what you've put before us this day. God, that we might apply it to our life. God, that we might leave this place different than when we came in, closer to you. We thank you and we praise you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen.
Hymn 779. I'll fly away and we're going to sing it like that too. Please stand. As we give back a portion of what you have given us so graciously, I pray that you will accept it to further your kingdom and that we will use it in a way that is pleasing to you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Verse 19, let's take a look at it. Jesus asked the question, who do the crowd say that I am? Who do the people of this day say that I am? And they said, or they answered and said, John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. And others say that one of the old prophets has risen again. Everyone has an opinion of Jesus. Everybody during his time had an opinion of Jesus. Every single one of you sitting here this morning have an opinion of Jesus. Now, since all of you here in church, I assume you have a pretty high opinion of Jesus. I'm assuming that. But that doesn't separate you from even the people of Jesus' day, the ones who eventually crucified him. Okay, just because you have a high opinion of Jesus doesn't necessarily separate you. You see, look at who they thought he was. They thought he was John the Baptist. Listen, John the Baptist, if I could be compared to John the Baptist, I'd take that as a compliment any day. If somebody said, man, Bo, you're like Elijah. That's how good you preach. That's how good you speak. Man, I would take that as a compliment. I'd be like, wow, that's pretty awesome. You think pretty highly of me. And then they said, you know what? Some people think that he's a prophet that had risen. That's pretty amazing. So they thought pretty highly of Jesus, right? Those are some pretty good compliments. So they didn't have, at this point in time, a very low opinion of Jesus. They didn't really want to kill Jesus until he claimed to be God, which they called blasphemy. But I think that it really, they wanted to continue in their sins. They didn't really want to give their life over to him and follow him, okay? That's a sermon for another day. But at this point, they thought fairly highly of Jesus. They had a fairly highly opinion of him. Those were compliments to anybody else but Jesus. Those are pretty good compliments. But notice who Peter says Jesus is in verse 20. Look at what he says. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered and said, "The Christ of God." As a matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 16, verse 16, Matthew records Peter saying this, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, what does that mean? You're the Christ of God. You're Christ, the Son of the living God. Well, when Peter referred to Jesus as the Christ, he was calling Jesus the Messiah. All right? That's what he was saying. In other words, Peter was saying that Jesus was sent by God to redeem man back to himself. That's what Peter was saying, to take away the sins of the world. Now, if you remember back to Matthew chapter 1, I'm sure most of you do. We'll hear a lot of it come December time because that has a lot to do with Christmas. If you remember back to Matthew chapter 1, Joseph was there sleeping, and an angel, or he had a dream, and he was visited. And they told him to name the babe that Mary was carrying, Jesus. Remember that? Well, Jesus basically means he saves. If you say it in Hebrew, it's Yeshua. You know, even Joshua from the Old Testament, Yeshua, that means he saves. And we know what Joshua did. But then when Christ was born, when Jesus was born, he was to be called Yeshua, or Jesus as we know him today, which means he saves. And so when Peter claims him or calls him Jesus the Christ, he's saying you're the Messiah who saves. You're the one to redeem man back to himself. And they've been looking for this Messiah for thousands of years. Thousands of years. And so Peter says that Jesus is of God. And by that he declared his deity. He declared Jesus his divinity. So basically Peter said Jesus is God. All right? That's basically what he said. Now let's stop right there for a moment. Peter said Jesus is God. God being the transcendent one. All right? Supreme authority. Jesus has supreme authority. He is the uncaused cause. All right? There's some deep thoughts about God. But that's what Peter was saying when he said Jesus is God. So Peter said that Jesus was the one who would take away the sins of the world by calling him the Christ. And he also said Jesus is God. And so these are all words. Who do you say Jesus is? Better yet, who does your life say Jesus is? We have a few examples throughout the Bible of people who had a unique an intimate encounter with Jesus Christ. Think back to Moses. I think that, I don't know if you guys have studied Moses in Sunday school yet or not, but think back to Moses. Most of you know Moses. And he was there in the wilderness, and God spoke to him. He had an encounter with Christ, with God, in the burning bush. You remember that? Joshua, after they were defeated, whenever they were taking over the promised land, there in Joshua chapter 5, verse 14, Joshua had an encounter with Jesus. We call that a Christophany. That's an appearance of Jesus before his physical birth. Okay? So he had an encounter with Jesus in Joshua chapter 5, verse 14. Also think about Isaiah. You're familiar with the story of Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6, where he was in the throne room of God, right? And the glory of God was all around. And Isaiah fell on his face and he confessed his uncleanness. You remember that? Woe is me. Oh, he was in the presence. God didn't even say anything to him at that point. He just was in the presence of the glory of God. And he said, woe is me. I am a man of unclean lips. And so he confessed his uncleanness. He had an encounter with Jesus. And then what about the three disciples, Peter, James, and John? You remember, they had a special connection with Jesus. And Jesus took them up on the mount one day. You remember the Mount of Transfiguration? Jesus went over there. He kind of unclothed himself of his flesh, and he transfigured himself. And what did they say? They say, it is good for us to be here, right? And then Peter said, hey, let's build a tabernacle for Moses. Let's build one for Elijah. Let's build one for Jesus. And let's never go back home. Let's stay here forever. That's kind of the mentality that they had. They had an intimate encounter with Jesus, and they were just overwhelmed with Him. They were amazed at what they saw and who Jesus was. Right? They didn't want to leave. None of these. They had this encounter, and they were amazed by it. Listen to me. When you have a personal, intimate encounter with Jesus, life will not stay the way it was. Amen? Amen. When you have a personal, intimate encounter with Christ, your life will not stay the same. Will not stay the same. There are a lot of people who come and play church, and they go through the baptismal waters, they say a prayer with the church or whatever, or the preacher and all that kind of stuff, but nothing ever changes. Listen, if you don't get changed, I'm not saying like it's immediate, and I'm not saying that it's easy and it's gone or anything. I'm not saying you got to work at it, but I'm telling you, when a person comes to Christ, they change. It's the evidence of the Holy Spirit living within a person. And we'll talk about that at another time, another sermon. But I'm just telling you, when a person has a personal, intimate encounter with Christ, they will not stay the same. Things will change. You will change. Your life will change. Let me let you in on a little secret this morning. Your life will reveal whether or not you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is God or just a religious figure. I want you to think about that for a moment. I want you to examine your life, not for your neighbor, not for your spouse, this is for you. Your life will reveal whether or not you believe in your heart Jesus is the Christ of God or just a religious figure. C.S. Lewis, one of my favorite writers, writes this. He says, Christianity, if false, is of no importance. And if true, of infinite importance. The only thing it cannot be is moderately important. I want to read that again. That's a very profound statement. And then I want you to ask yourself, how do I live? How do I live with this statement in mind? It says, Christianity, if false, is of no importance. So it's false, not important at all, right? And if true, if Christ is who He says He is, if He truly is God, died on the cross, arose from the dead, ascended into heaven, preparing a place for us, if He truly is who He says He is, then it is of infinite importance. There is nothing more important than that. If it's true, the only thing it cannot be is moderately important. Can't be a little bit important. Can't be pretty important. Let that sink in for just a moment. See, to Peter, who answered Jesus' question here, Jesus was everything. Jesus was everything to Peter. Did Peter make mistakes? Absolutely. Did he stick his foot in his mouth? Absolutely. We've looked at those. We've studied Peter. We know what kind of person Peter is. We can relate to Peter. But I'm telling you right now, Jesus was everything to Peter. Everything to Peter. Some historians have written that Peter was crucified upside down for his faith. And some say that it was because he didn't feel worthy to be crucified right side up like Jesus was. See, Jesus was everything to Peter. Jesus was everything to John. Peter was everything to James, to Matthew, to all those disciples. How do I know? Well, because they ultimately died because of their faith. All but one. And John, they tried to kill him. They couldn't kill him. He died of old age after he wrote the revelation of Jesus Christ. But Peter, Jesus was everything to Peter. He saw Jesus as the Christ of God. Infinitely important. Nothing in this life more important than Jesus. Too many people sitting on church pews all over this world, all over this nation, see Jesus as moderately important. You see Jesus as moderately important. And more important enough to come to church, right? Jesus is important enough for me to come to church on Sunday mornings, but not important enough for me to invest everything I have for the kingdom. Give a portion of my time, talent, and tithe. Important enough to read a verse or do a devotion every day, but not important enough to make known my faith to everyone I come in contact with. Important enough to sing a few songs to, right? But not important enough to volunteer time with young people or to help feed those who are hungry in a soup kitchen or something like that. You see, Jesus is important. I mean, we'll dress up, we'll look nice, and we'll smell nice, and we'll come to church. But he's not so important that I'm really willing to step outside my comfort zone and do something that I don't really feel like doing. Not really comfortable enough. He's important to me, but not so much that I'm willing to risk embarrassment to do something for him. Jesus speaks to the moderately important group in Revelation chapter 3 when he says, "I'd rather you be hot or cold, but because you are lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth." That tells us how strongly Jesus despises lukewarmness. How strongly Jesus despises people who view him as moderately important. And so I close by asking you again, who do you say Jesus is? Who do you say Jesus is? See, the modern church and Christianity has made following Christ to be some glamorous idea of great blessings and wonderful experiences. I'm telling you, I'm amazed at how prosperity churches are just booming. And their ideology is just this, that Christianity, that following Christ is this glamorous idea of great blessings and wonderful experiences. Now, I'm not saying that being a Christ follower does not have blessings. Listen, you follow Christ, you'll be blessed, all right? But you also have trials, you also have tribulations. Isn't that what John writes, 16:33? But at the core of following Christ is death. At the core of following Christ is death. Jesus said, "Take up your cross and follow me." Paul wrote, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." The cross is not glamorous. It's deadly. The cross is not glamorous. It's deadly. When you take up the cross, it strips you of your desires because you realize you're not worthy. When you take up the cross to follow Jesus because he's infinitely important to you, your desires are stripped away because you realize I'm not worthy to be in a right relationship with God. I'm not worthy to have anything I want. God, what do you want? You're the one who paid the price. The cross brings you to a place of humility, brokenness, and gratitude. As a matter of fact, that's why the Romans used the crucifixion. That's why they used the cross. And the way they did it, see, when somebody was sentenced to the cross, death by crucifixion, what they would do is basically they broke a Roman law. And so you went against the Romans, and their way of getting back at you is you had to not only be killed upon a cross, but you had to carry your cross from the place that you were sentenced to the place that you're going to be crucified with the streets full of people. And it was like this big parade. And so here you are, you've been beaten, you've carrying your cross upon your back, so it brings about this humility. It's like you're coming under submission to the Roman government. And that was the whole point of the cross, is to bring you to a place of humility under the Roman law. And so when it says to take up your cross and follow me, you're getting rid of all your desires. You're coming to a place of humility
under Christ and submission to Him, just like if you were crucified by Romans, you were coming under submission to them. And so when a person was crucified, it brought them to a place of humility and brokenness. But with the cross of Christ, it brings you to a place of gratitude as well. Christ has not called us to a life of luxury. Now, if you've been blessed to that point, praise the Lord. It's because He gives it to you, that you have that. But God didn't call us to a life of luxury. He called us to a life of submission. He called us to a life of humility. He called us to a life of meekness. Read the Beatitudes. It'll explain it all to you. So who does your life say Jesus is? Who does your life say Jesus is? If you believe that Jesus is who He says He is, then you absolutely cannot live as if He's moderately important. If you believe that Jesus is who He says He is, you cannot live as if He is moderately important. If Jesus is who He says He is, then He deserves your life and He deserves your all. I want you to search your life this morning. I want you to search your heart this morning. Is there anything in your life that you have not surrendered to God? Is there anything in your life that you've not surrendered to God? Jesus is either of no importance to you, of which you can stay right where you are, or He is infinitely important to you to the point to give Him your life. Here's the beauty of it all, and I'm going to close. Jesus is calling you to come just as you are, just as we sang just a moment ago, to come just as you are. You don't got to sit there and say, work it all out. Okay, if I come down and I give my life to Christ, then I've got to get rid of this, then I've got to get rid of that, then I've got to stop doing this. That's not what the invitation's all about. See, the invitation is all about you coming and saying, you know what? I am a wretched sinner, and I can't do it on my own, so I'm coming to Christ. And then allow Christ to work on you from the inside out. That's why we sing, come just as you are. That's why we say, come just as you are. That's why we don't look at you and look down upon you if, you know, maybe somebody comes in not dressed with a suit and a tie or whatever. Listen, it doesn't matter. Jesus says, come just as you are. When you come, He'll do the work. He just wants you to come and submit. That's the beauty of it. He's calling you to bring Him your broken life in exchange for His eternal life. He's calling you with all your failures, with all your mistakes, with all your sins, and exchange it for His righteousness. That's what He's calling you to. He's calling you to bring all of your burdens in exchange for rest. Jesus says, come all those who are weary and heaven laden or burdened, I will give you rest. There's some in here today, I'm sure, that are burdened. I don't know where you are struggling in life, whatever it is. Jesus is saying, come, just as you are. I'll give you rest. Lay your burdens down. Cast them at His feet. As Peter writes, he said, cast your burdens upon Him, for He cares for you. All you have to do is believe that Jesus is who He says He is and give Him your life today. And then He'll begin a work in your life. So if that's you this morning, won't you come? Won't you give your life to Christ? As we stand, as Ronnie, Benita come, Linda comes. Father, we thank You for the invitation that You've given every single one of us this morning. God, You don't require us to fix our problems, to fix our burdens, to work out the struggles that we're going through. But God, You simply called us to come and lay them at Your feet. God, in the Old Testament, the altar was a place where prayers went up. In heaven, there is an altar even before the throne, and there's a place where prayers went up. And God, I know that there's some here today who are burdened, struggling. Lord, I pray that they offer those up to You. God, that they seek Your face. But God, most of all, I pray if there's any here this morning who considers Christ moderately important. God, I pray that you convict our heart. And God, if there's any in here who says that Christ is of no importance, God, I pray that you help them realize this morning through the power of the Holy Spirit that he is infinitely important. And that without him, Lord, there's nothing. There is no hope. There's nothing. So God, speak to us as we go through this time of invitation. Meet with us and be with us. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hymn 479, Softly and Tenderly.
Consider the question that we started the service out with. Who do you say Jesus is? Better yet, who does your life say Jesus is? He's either of no importance or infinite importance. There is no middle ground. Maybe you've gone through the motions, you've kind of made him somewhat important in your life, but you know that that's not what you're called to do. Maybe there's an area in your life you're not selling out to him in. Maybe you need to do that this morning. Just consider that question. Who does our life say Jesus is? Jesus asked the disciples, who do you say that I am? And you may think very highly of Jesus. But if he is not your Savior, if you've not given your life to him, then you're missing the purpose of who Jesus is. For he came. Lay down his life so that you might have life. So just another moment, we're going to close. I'm going to give you the opportunity. If you've never given your life to Christ, won't you come? They play one more stanza, and we're going to close. Won't you come? Give your life to Christ. Be eternally forever changed. head and open your eyes. I've got a few announcements that I want to make before we're dismissed. I have a card here that I want to read. It says, "Thanks so much. A simple act of kindness has a beauty all its own." It says, "Thank you for your kindness. A special thank you for all the prayers, cards, calls, love, and concern shown for us during our bout with the flu. We are so thankful and appreciative for our church family and the support you extended to us. Thank you, and God bless. Love, Dalton and BJ." Now, got that this week. Dalton's actually back in the hospital, so keep him and BJ in prayer. They think that he may have gotten a blood clot in his lung. They're working to get that taken care of, but keep him in your prayers. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we will have a regular service time anyway. We're going to cut it short. We're probably going to get out of here about 6:30 so that we can go be with the Mervin family at Jones Funeral Home as they receive friends and family tonight from 6 to 8 up here at Jones. And then the funeral is tomorrow at 11 o'clock here at the church. So if you are on that team to bring food, get with Judy. She hasn't already gotten with you so that we can be prepared for that. So the funeral for Miss Kathleen is tomorrow at 11 o'clock here at the church. Visitations tonight, 6 to 8 over at Jones. We'll be leaving from here about 6:30, going over there being with the family at that time. We do have a few announcements. If you notice in the back of your bulletin, there was a meeting tonight for the barbecue benefit. That has been canceled because there's also a memorial service for Ruffin Jarman at the gathering, Surf City Baptist Church. And what time is that? Somebody. So 3 to 4, then the service is at 4. So that's at the gathering, Surf City. So no meeting tonight for that.
But it is Wednesday night, 6.
Meeting's Wednesday night, 6 o'clock. So it has been changed. Take a look at all the other stuff. We've got our T-shirts. If you're interested in that, pick one of them up. See Gail, can see Linda, can see Jody. They'll all be glad to point you in the right direction for that. Don't forget about your PBC stickers. Any other announcements that we need to make? Deacons meeting tomorrow, 6 o'clock. WMU Tuesday at 10 o'clock. So make plans to be here for those. Anyone else? All right. Hearing none, I'm going to ask if Elvin will close us in a word of prayer.